panel titled Generation Next, How Do We Ensure Western Sydney's Infrastructure is Fit for the Future? On this panel, we have James Boulderstone, Chief Executive Officer, National Intermodal, and Simon Hickey, Chief Executive Officer, Western Sydney Airport, with provocateur Alyssa Anastasio. Alyssa is Community Engagement Officer at Western Sydney Airport and is part of Generation West, which is a group of young, passionate individuals with strong ties to Greater Western Sydney. Gen West provides a youth-driven perspective for the discussion and activism and is led by the Western Sydney Leadership Dialogue. Please welcome James, Simon and Alyssa.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm absolutely delighted to be here with Simon and James, the CEOs of two nationally significant projects right here in Western Sydney. Before we kick off the panel, we'd like to set the scene. So first, we'll be showing you a video of National Intermodal with an introduction from James.
Very good, thank you. Can I see the video? I've got to stand and see it. So intermodal terminals are pretty fantastic things if you've never seen one. So they take these great products off these massive container ships that travel around the world, and they deliver them into Port Botany, one of Australia's biggest ports, and then we've built a dedicated freight line all the way to Australia's largest, most sophisticated infrastructure logistics park. And here it is as we currently look at it. It's about a third built. That facility there is the Woolworths $1.2 billion facility, a national distribution centre in the heart of Western Sydney. It is absolutely state-of-the-art. There is nothing actually in the Southern Hemisphere that rivals the quality and the sustainability of this sort of facility. What we'll see in a moment is installation on the top of these sheds of Australia's biggest solar array. At the moment, what's being installed out there is enough renewable energy to be self-sufficient of this precinct, and in fact, it'll be able to power 40,000 homes in Western Sydney. It really is a state-of-the-art facility. It's absolutely incredible that we've got this park there. I have the pleasure of bringing many other people from other states to view this facility at the moment, and everyone that goes there is absolutely gobsmacked of what we've built. It's on 250 hectares, so it's on a grand scale, and it's an absolute pleasure to be here to talk about it. You, Simon.
Great. Thanks, James. We will now show you a short video from Western Sydney Airport, followed by an introduction by Simon.
It looks pretty good, doesn't it? We're on track to open in 2026. Western Sydney Airport is the most transformational piece of infrastructure in Sydney since the Harbour Bridge. It's actually going to move the economy, jobs, opportunity, growth west. For the first time, Sydney stopped going to go east and we're going to come west. Right next door, and pivotal of the airport, 24/7 airport being there. We're going to have Bradfield City being built with 200,000 jobs that are going to be built there. We've got thousands of jobs, tens of thousands of jobs that will come to the airport. We're designing this airport for growth. So it will start where we will have a capacity of 10 million annual passengers. To put that in perspective, 10 million annual passengers will make us the fifth largest airport in Australia. But over the decades ahead, we will grow to a capacity of 82 million annual passengers, which is in line with JFK or Dubai today. We will be Sydney's international and domestic gateway for Sydney, the airport for Sydney.
Great. Well, I think you both already touched on some of the benefits that both these projects will bring, but I'm keen to jump straight into a discussion. But first, I want to let you know that today we'll be running this session on my terms. And what I mean by that is young people consume information differently. They consume it quickly. And so there's a couple rules of play for this session. Number one, no corporate speak. And number two, I'm going to put you on a 90-second time limit for each answer. So you'll hear a buzzer when your time is up. Are we good to go?
Good to go.
Awesome. So, my first question is, what's the significance of Western Sydney International and National Intermodal for future Western Sydney generations? We might start with you, James, and we'll get the clock counting down.
Yeah, look, it's amazing when you look at what you need to develop an international state-of-the-art facility. You know, you need land, you need connectivity, and you need passionate people who drive it. And that's one thing that Western Sydney has in spades. And again, when I compare the opportunities that we have and what we've developed here and how to replicate that in other jurisdictions, it really does show how far ahead and how far Western Sydney has come. And as Simon's touched on before, the opportunities that they can grow from that, you know, we talk about jobs and these big numbers and what all these facilities can do. But if you look at the size of the Woolley Shed, and that's one of five or six of those facilities that'll be on that precinct. And when it's completed, there'll be like something like 7,000 jobs in the park itself. And these jobs are jobs of the future for people who live here. You know, it's all about automation, robotics, how these facilities become super efficient to make up for the cost of the construction. So, you know, these are state-of-the-art great facilities.
Look at that, ahead of time. Love it.
Well, I'm very, Simon. Very tight.
Simon, over to you and we'll restart the clock.
Okay, thanks, Alyssa. Well, this is our airport. So this is an airport. So we've got an airport in Sydney already, Kingsford Smith, and there's about 250,000 people that live in the eastern suburbs. This is for the 5 million rest of us. This is an airport that is going to grow with our population. And it's going to be an airport that everyone in the world's looking at. I was speaking to the CEO of Heathrow Airport, one of the busiest airports in the world, and they're looking at us as to say, well, what can you do with a greenfield airport? How can you lead the world in technology, in sustainability, in the things that matter in terms of aviation and customer experience and passenger experience? So we've got a real opportunity here to really demonstrate what we can do to the world. And so I think that's the non-corporate speak. In terms of a bit of corporate speak, by 2060, we're projected to contribute $24 billion in GDP. And GDP just means jobs and growth. It means that you've got opportunities coming out of this airport that we haven't seen before, and they're going to be centred here in the West.
Perfect. Thank you both. My next question is around jobs, and more specifically, how are both projects contributing to the upskilling of Western Sydney's future workforce, and how are we preparing for those jobs? So we'll start again with you, James, if that's all right.
Yeah, thank you. Look, we've obviously touched both on the job prospects, but it's interesting when you just don't talk about what a precinct of whether it's the airport or whether it's the intermodal can do, but it rewires in some degree the network that surrounds the precinct itself. So I've mentioned these 7,000 jobs that'll be on site, but there's a multiplier effect. You know, you would have three to four times that in associated jobs and skills that are needed to actually, you know, facilitate the precinct. I'm actually from Adelaide, and I remember when Holden closed down, you have these massive precincts that are, you know, Elizabeth and South Australia, and it wasn't just the workforce there that lost their jobs, it was this huge infrastructure that was around it. And one of the great things I think about these two projects, it is the government reinvesting back in manufacturing, supply chain, All those things where we actually talk and actually make ourselves safe and sustainable. And what that really shows is that you need these sort of locations to deliver these sort of projects.
Great. Simon?
Jobs. It's going to be about 4,000 people working on our site next year. So that's a lot of jobs in itself. More than 50% or around 50% of people come from Western Sydney, and that's the construction work that's going on at the moment. So, but that's only a small component of once we become operational, when we've got a cargo precinct, we've got our passenger air operations going, and we've got a business park that's 200 hectares, which is the size of the Parramatta CBD. Actually, we've got to grow our own. So we've got to get people interested now in the jobs and opportunities that are going to become available at the airport and in the surrounding infrastructure. So we've got a skills program. We've directly gone and spoken to 8,500 kids in schools about opportunities at the airport. We get kids and schools to come to the airport we take them to the experience centre that we've built. We've signed a partnership, Generation STEM, with CSIRO, which is to get kids interested in STEM subjects, which are going to abound in our area. We've signed a partnership with the Powerhouse Museum here in Parramatta, again, centred around education in STEM and using both their facilities and our facilities. We've got a partnership with TAFE, where we've brought people to look at aviation jobs, and we're working with Western Sydney University in that as well.
Great.
Up of the cliff now,
just
I think.
In time.
I gotta go.
Well, my final question is around young people caring in particular a lot about the environment and sustainability. So how do these two projects contribute to a more sustainable future? And what are the environmental outcomes or benefits that these two mega projects will bring? So I think you know the drill now. Over to you, James.
I'm first off the rack. Look, it's interesting. People often told me when I came into this job that freight doesn't vote. But what I did say is that, you know, products on supermarket shelves definitely does vote. And to not only to get those products, you know, in an affordable manner and an available manner, it's got to be delivered sustainable. And what we've seen over the last 20 years is an underinvestment really across the supply chain. Moving large freight by rail is 18 times more carbon efficient than moving them by trucks. You know, the freight challenge that's coming down the pathway at the east coast of Australia is some 270 billion tonnes of extra freight that needs to be moved. So how do you do that? You're innovative, you have vision, you actually look at ways to actually do things differently. You know, one of the things, the learnings from COVID was Australia, again, not did it just hollow out its manufacturing base, it relied too much on overseas entities to manage, you know, critical products that we need. We've now got the chance to reinvest in these facilities in the most sustainable way. You've seen the pictures of the solar arrays. You know, to put it again in context, 150 megawatts can be on the roofs. That is Australia's biggest installed solar facility right here. And again, we also then talk about retrofitting for hydrogen in the future as well. So there's great opportunities of technology and the need for smart people to help us grow and go into the future.
Great. Just in time. Simon, over to you.
Well, sustainability is a really big issue in aviation, and I think you've got to solve it on the ground first. So it's been a real focus for us at the airport. In construction, so we've got 98% non-potable water that we're using. We're using 400,000 square metres of recycled concrete. We're using a concrete mix which will make it greener where we can across the airport. We're using passive design in the terminal so that we use actually less power in generating air conditioning and ensuring that it's hot in the right times and cold in the right times. So we're doing that by design. But that also includes things like taxiways. So our taxiways on average will be 5 minutes. Kingsford Smith is an example, is 17 minutes. So all of the fuel that's burnt by the aircraft when they're on the ground going there. We're looking at solar on the roof. So solar on the roof will provide 20% of the terminal needs from day one, and we're also collecting water on the roof. We're looking at solar array elsewhere. We've done an inventory of air space that will be available, and we've got a lot of hectares that we can put solar up. And similarly, we're looking at what we do for nighttime environment as well to ensure that that's sustainable. So across the range, including then vehicles and charging and EVs, we're looking at that across this airport.
Perfect, great. Well, that brings us to the final section of this panel. And we'll be finishing off with some questions from young adults in Western Sydney. My fellow members of the Dialogues Generation West program, Leonie Nahas and Joshua Santos, will each ask you one question. And just to keep things interesting, we're going to reduce the time to 45 seconds. But you both seem like pros at a minute and a half, so this should be a breeze. I'll hand over to Leonie, who's got a question for Simon.
Thanks, Alyssa. So my question, so I actually work within the Department of Education, and so I'm interested in the engagement of the airport with the education sector, particularly around what you were saying, how does engagement with the education sector encourage transferable skill sets for young people?
So, what we're doing in terms of engaging with the education, first thing you've got to do is lift the eyes of the kids to say, hey, there's a real future here, there's real jobs that I'm interested in doing. And what we find is that, so that involves us going out to schools. What we're also working on is a competency model of all of the different types of jobs and what they involve so that we can work with universities and TAFE so that they can include that in their courses that they're delivering. So people are job ready when we're opening. It's no point in being job ready 3 years after we're opening. So we're working on those sorts of competency models and then talking to TAFE, talking to universities about delivering that. I would say that we're then trying to bring people and show them what an airport looks like.
Great. And if I could just echo that, I've been lucky to be involved in a lot of our school engagement programs, and just seeing the students' faces absolutely light up when we talk about the diverse nature of the jobs and the careers that the airport will be bringing at a time where they're just about to finish school or just about to finish university. It's amazing to be a part of that and watch their faces just absolutely light up. So thank you, Leonie. And I will hand over now to Joshua, who's got a question for James.
Hi, James. I'm Joshua. I'm currently working at Macquarie University through their student mobility team on employability and skills building projects. James, you've had a very impressive and successful career. What would be your advice to aspiring future leaders in Western Sydney?
Oh, what a great question. I come from a very, very small country town, and I was the first person in my family to go to university. And one of the things I suppose I learned originally was be confident and proud in your own ability. Western Sydney people are not only equal to the others that they'll come across, they're better because they're from more diverse experiences and backgrounds, and that what gives you the ability to actually be more effective immediately in the workplace. I also think what we saw during COVID was that this region not only is the engine room of Sydney, so when it shut down, Sydney stopped, but it really highlighted how important it was to actually get everyone sort of working together. So great opportunities, keep driving forward, world's your oyster, just go.
Great, and that's time. So this brings us to the end of our panel, but I'd like to just thank you both for firstly playing by the rules almost, and but more importantly for bringing us to a better understanding of, you know, all of the opportunities that both these projects will bring for not only the youth of today, but for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.